Hi, my name's Steve. Welcome aboard my narrowboat home, Moreland Rose. Please join me as I take a slow boat through Britain. I rejoin Moreland Rose at the mooring at the top of the Wolverhampton lock flight. Time to look at the industrial nature of our canals now. It is quite a pleasant mooring here by this small park, and quieter than I was expecting. I had spotted these moorings to starboard on Google Map, but there doesn't appear to be any way to get to the street. I suppose this is the urban version of a steep cutting. Fewer trees though. These fairly new apartments have at least been built with the canal in mind. Birmingham Canal Navigations are full of junctions leading to factory wharves or to separate parts of the system. This one leads to Warsaw via the Wylie and Essington Canal. As I mentioned in my last vlog, the bridges on the BCN only have names, no numbers. With the amount of interlinked canals, the numbers would have been meaningless anyway. two small branches off to starboard are all that remains of Pickford's Wharf. Pickford's, a transport company, opened their offices here in 1821 and ran flyboats to all parts of the country, day and night delivering perishable goods. The flyboats were given preference at locks to help speed up their journey. Much of this area was taken up by various ironworks, all of whom used the canal to transport goods and materials. Most have now disappeared, and the land used for other purposes. The derelict structure to port is the Crane of Chillington Ironworks. It was used to transfer goods between the canal and the railway. Boats used to enter the wharf through the side bridge we will pass in a moment. The Canada geese seem ever present, even here. This narrow section was a gauging station. They are found all around the BCN. Canals made their money by charging tolls for goods carried. All boats using the BCN were logged in a register showing how deep in the water they floated when loaded with known weights. At these gauging stations, the freeboard, or clearance above the waterline, was measured, and the toll for the type of goods carried calculated. The canal continues to wind its way between factory sites and more modern housing. This is the first boat I've seen moving in a few days. It's not all industrial scenery, with the occasional wildlife area. The towpath is very well maintained, being part of the National Cycle Route 81, which connects Wolverhampton with Aberystwyth on the Welsh coast. Another junction, this time the Wensbury Oak Loop, leading to the CRT Bradley Workshop where they produce new lock gates. I was surprised to see this collection of coot. Up to now it's only been Canada geese. Did you know the collective name for a group of coot is a covert or cover? The section of canal we're on is the old main line, completed in 1772. And as you've seen, it twists and turns around the contours. As traffic got heavier and heavier, it was decided to construct a secondary, more direct route. So straight ahead here, the canal drops down to the new main line, which was completed by 1827. But that's for another time. It's wonderful to see youngsters here being taught the canal is a great place for leisure, not just for graffiti. The white building in the distance is the Fountain Pub. It is known for being the headquarters of a 19th century prize fighter, William Perry, the Tipton Slasher. He became English heavyweight champion in 1850, beating Tom Paddock in a fight lasting 27 rounds. Time to call it a day. That wind is cold when stood on the stern, so a nice hot shower, and the stove's been keeping the inside toasty warm all day, and perhaps a pint or two in the fountain. It's been a different scenery today, but I find it interesting. I hope you'll agree. As always, it's been great to have you along for the ride. I hope to see you next time as I head into the heart of Birmingham. Until then, stay safe, and I'll see you soon.